you haven't seen Berto's work, you're about to, and enjoy the clips.
Hey, guys. Just barely made breakfast.
Huh. Long shower line.
Yeah, it was really awful today.
Your hair's dry.
Hey.
I can't believe people actually live up here, bro.
Excuse me.
There is like nothing around.
What the fuck?
Ah! Oh, shit. You're like RoboCop.
I think you have the wrong house.
Nah, I get it now. You can't get a real job. That's why they got you up here in Sleepy Hollow. Yo, Daya know you're a cyborg?
Excuse me?
Guess she must by now, right?
Okay, who the hell are you?
I'm a friend of the family, bro.
All right, well, you need to leave. Now.
When I heard what was going on, I got really concerned. Because I love them Diaz girls. And then I heard it was a prison guard slipping it to my Daya bubble. I know you're not taking her to a dinner and a movie first. But I hear you was in the army, so I figured you must have some kind of honor code or something, right? You wouldn't just get a girl pregnant and forget about it, would you?
What?
Where are you gonna put the crib, bro?
What are you talking about?
It's kind of cramped in here, bro. Maybe you should think about getting a two-bedroom so kids can have their own room. For when you're fucking bitches.
Who are you?
Sorry, I'm looking, for César?
César! Some white boy here.
Baby daddy. ¿Qué pasó? Diana Leda, okay?
Yeah. Yeah, no, great. I know you said to stop by sometimes. Here I am. Also, I brought this gift for Lucy. And, I proposed to Daya, actually.
No fucking way! Get in here! Homeboy, stepping up to the plate! Diablo, ¿cómo se va a casar? Margarita, listen to this. How'd you do it? Did you get a ring?
I made it, actually, out of gum wrappers. Gum was how we met, so.
Babe, what's up? Dinner? You need to get her a real ring.
Yeah, no, definitely. I just, I mean, she can't have it in prison, though, because she'll get, you know, shanked for it. The boss will ask me where she got it, or... But I think the gum ring is fine for now. Mm. Hey, who's...
I'm a daddy again. And I know you ain't gonna say shit to her later, right? Or do I have to bribe you with, like, movies and candies like I do with them? How many times? Look what you did. You broke this shit.
Hi, you're Lucy, right?
I'm Lucy.
Oh, sorry. Happy birthday. Dinar asked me to bring you this.
Is it a Barbie?
I guess you'll have to open it and find out. No, it's not a Barbie, but it's cool.
Then now, bitches.
That was fast.
Yeah, leftovers from Storky's.
Hey, I should probably get going. I just wanted to drop off the thing and tell you the good news.
Nice try, homeboy. You staying for dinner. Eat your french fries, puto.
I'm not hungry for vegetables.
Hey.
Oh, pero listen to you. Don't you talk to him that way. He pays your rent.
That's right. So you gotta listen to what I say, because otherwise, there'll be behavioral consequences.
Man, when you put them in the microwave, they get disgusting. I'm not eating them.
brought you French fries. You better get fucking hungry real quick. Emiliano, do me a favor. Get the fuck out of my face. I know I look strict, right? But secretly, deep down inside, they're just happy that there's actually an adult in charge. Sit down, eat, eat. Look at you, round and round, round all around. That's nice.
Just get to it. Did you find him?
Daya, that fucker hobbled away into the sunset. I got into his house, nothing left. Except some shitty clothes. Found a mug in the sink that looked like a grenade. I thought that was cool, I saved that for you. But he's gone. Daya, fuck that guy. You're better off. He had one leg. I mean, you go around losing body parts? That's some pretty irresponsible shit.
I was such a bitch. I drove him away.
You have a life growing inside of you. That makes you say and do all kinds of crazy shit that make no sense. But a real man knows he has to suck it up and take it. For 9 months, maybe you get a little side action if need be. But you don't split. Even your looser father stuck around till you was two. The leaving is on him. That's not on you.
So what's gonna happen now? You're gonna take the baby, right?
Daya, I love you and I love your mother, but shit is real hard out here, okay? And then your holy abuela, you know, she hooking up with some old dude that she met in Tai Chi, hardly ever see her anymore. Christina got some decent mommy skills. Maybe she can take care of the baby for a little while.
She's in junior high.
So what? Junior high will still be there. Plus, she's already done, what, 2 years? Yo, it's all good. It's all good.
I actually thought he loved me.
And he probably did, Daya. All guys love you because you're such a good girl. But you know what? Sometimes love ain't stronger than devil. That guy was a bitch.
This inside me, it feels like a grenade right now. And soon it's gonna blow up and take me with it. It's not a mug. My poor baby, man.
He's not good.
I'm sorry, Daya. If it makes you feel any better. Next time I see that motherfucker, I'm gonna rape his ass with a broken bottle and I'm gonna shoot him in the stomach so he bleeds slow. That I'm gonna do for you.
Thank you.
Welcome.
I'd like to give a very warm WestCon welcome to Berto Colón. Please
Yee-hee!
Come on out.
Thank you, guys. Thanks, man. Appreciate it.
Welcome.
Thank you, guys. Thank you.
One of the most adorable moments where I just saw Berto, the father, collide with César, the father, right? And because of some sensitive content, we invited Berto's girls in the back because otherwise some R-rated material there, I guess you could say safely.
Yeah.
So I've explained to Berto really what our student population is like, and that today it's going to be all about really talking about how he became an actor, how he got into acting, and really provide some frames of reference with regards to those of you interested in going in a media production or a broadcast or even an acting direction. So on that note, why don't we start it out from the beginning?
Yeah.
Where did you start and what was your first little break with regards to acting?
Yeah, so you know, I was on track to be this. I went to school, basically college, on a football scholarship. I was always
big jock and sports guy, and I really, really loved football. And then while I was there at Fordham, I got injured a couple times. I blew my knee out, actually more than once. And so certain realities start to set in, and you know, you and Mark being my brother, basically, and he was studying. Mark is your roommate at SUNY Purchase. They were studying directing, and even before that, we had always had this. It was like a dream, really, to be honest with you. It was sort of like this little idea that we had, this little spark somewhere in the back of our heads that we wanted to really do this, you know, do work and write films and work in them. And so once this I experienced this, you know, sort of disappointment with football, I started to participate in the works that both, you know, Mark, obviously, but, you know, both you guys were doing up at SUNY Purchase. And that's where I really started to kind of had this idea that maybe I can do this. I mean, it's a long, much longer story than that. But the inception of that idea really started at, I guess right around junior year. I had a fifth year redshirt year at Fordham, so I got to go to school an extra year. And so in that last semester of my fifth year in school, I had already finished my major, and basically all my electives and all the work that I took was, you know, I almost got to that second major, but I didn't complete it. But anyway, every class I took that last semester, and a couple the fall semester, but mostly all in the spring, were just, you know, electives of, you know, video design and script writing and some script work, and then, you know, sound design and anything that had to do with, you know, technical aspects of the work. And not really much of acting at all. But then I started to get involved with some of the projects that you guys were doing up at SUNY Purchase. And that's really where I started to really think about this. I got to shoot my own film, two of them actually, in which we all starred and wrote and participated in really making this thing called Final Scene on Friday. I'll never forget it. And in the final scene, my character kills Mark's character right up the street from where we grew up. And that's always going to stay with me, because really that's when you do things on your own and you actually succeed, it's huge. I mean, it wasn't anything that anyone else got to see, but it was a huge success for me, and it was a starting point and
one of the things
confidence builder, I guess.
Yeah, one of the things we often talk about with our students is that foot in the door moment.
Yeah.
When you feel like, okay, now I have a path, I have something beyond school that I can count as my getting my foot in the door. Can you talk a little bit about what that moment was for you?
And so I'm gonna break some hearts today.
After school.
Yeah, I mean, after school, those moments come, and maybe a day later you realize that they weren't foot in the door, or feet in the door, if you will. but you know what? It's really about God. This is such a progress. Like, I'm not gonna lie, this is a very, you know, a lot of this, you know, to become an engineer is hard, to become a doctor is hard, to become a lawyer is very difficult. This work is, in comparison to that, I don't know if it's harder or easier, but this is so taxing on the mind, and it's so taxing on you as a person. You have a lot of, for the most part, you're gonna have a lot of lows, and these little short victories that you have are for the most part short-lived, because it's more of a struggle than anything else. And so this is the personal part of this work. This is, you always do this for you. You never do this for anyone else, to fulfill anyone else's fantasies or ideas about what they think you are. This is a very personal. And I guess that's why maybe it's so different from any other career, that this is an extremely personal and internal process. And really, the foot in the door moments are like this. And they should be for you. You know, you get to meet casting directors, you get to meet people, and this is all an evolution. But along the way, what you have to have is this understanding that every single time you arrive at those, it's not to please anyone else, it's not to make anyone else happy, it's only to make yourself happy. Because, you know, you could have a great audition and you may not get the job. And I mean, that's a foot in the door that got shut right in your face.
Absolutely. So, you know, this, I don't know if you got to see La La Land.
Oh yeah.
But La La Land is essentially the story.
That's a great
an actress,
yeah,
who breaks.
Yeah.
She goes home, she moves home, and then by the end of the movie, the happy ending, of course, she's the star,
yeah,
now. But
and that whole deception and how it affected, like how it is so personal, how it affects their lives, and then actually when you're there, even when you're there, you really don't reach any happiness, because turns out that she actually went a completely different direction, and they—I don't need to spoil it for anyone—but they don't end, and they don't end up together.
Right.
But there's that final scene was incredible, where they kind of like look at each other and like, you know, I'm still happy.
Sure.
I'm still. Again, those, yeah, are personal journeys, and you know, there's things you're not gonna have it all. You're not gonna have everything, but if at the end of the day you're doing this for yourself, and you believe in yourself, and you're about the growth, and you're about understanding that the only person that you got to really, really satisfy is yourself. I mean, I hope that the reason you're doing this is for some internal reason to begin with. So, but you know, along the way, you get caught up in a lot of things, you know, like, you know, money is a big deal. I mean, responsibilities, you want to survive, you know. I mean, I've been surviving on 2-3 jobs for the last, you know, 10, 12, 15 years, and it's taxing, you know. I'm not a spring chicken anymore, as they say. And there's certain things that I want to have a certain level of comfort so that I can go out and be relaxed and go do this work, you know. Because of course, as you grow in this industry, the work becomes a lot more involved, and the preparation for the work really is not, you know, an hour, whereas like you need days in advance, or maybe at least a full 24 hours of an undivided attention to the work, so you can really go in there and blow it out of the water, right? And have a great audition. So I want to have that level of comfort, and you know, that these are all I know I'm brainstorming a lot, but these are all the challenges that you're going to have as directors and writers and actors and PAs and sound people and key grips. Like, this entire industry is hustle, like eternal, forever hustle. You can be, you know, Guy Ritchie, and he's still hustling. He's hustling somebody to trust him to do the next
Guy Ritchie movie. Yeah.
Guy Ritchie movie. Because he's not putting up his money. He's not investing his money. Somebody's always going to have to back your projects up, and that's part of the deal. It never stops.
Another way I heard it framed is that, especially in the mainstream or commercial industry, you have to do two projects you don't want to do to be able to do one you really do want to do.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
So you have to, you know, pay the bills with those two, and then you finally maybe get to find one that
you
that
just have to. You just have to always. You're. I'm here now, but I'm already thinking about next week. It's kind of like the attitude. You know, I was lucky enough for the first time in my career. I shot a pilot a month ago. They flew me out to Vancouver, and I was lucky enough to work with all these, you know, seasoned vets, and you know, I guess I was kind of like the rookie, so to speak, of the group, but not rookie in the sense that I didn't know what I was doing, more in a sense of experience. And there wasn't any one of those people up there that didn't have a frame set of, okay, I'm in Vancouver from the 6th till the 6th, and once this is done, I'm already on to the next thing. Like, everyone is always two steps ahead. You're now, you're here, you're working at this moment, but you're anticipating, you know, what happens after this job is done and you're moving on to the next one.
Yeah.
It's just constant. So, you know, it doesn't stop.
Let's talk about César a little,
yeah,
and some of the things that are going on in these scenes. I mean, really some harsh things there, but also, you know, there's this contrast at play, because he is essentially the caregiver. He is taking care of the family while the mother is in prison.
Yeah.
Ironically enough, the prison in Orange is the New Black is based here in Danbury.
It's here. It's,
yeah,
near, it's it used to be an old. It's an old child psychiatric ward.
Yeah.
And those walls, yeah, and those doors were there.
Right.
Some really bizarre stuff. That in the first year of shooting that series, we got to go up there because they basically, you know, the production borrowed like the West Wing, which had been decommissioned or whatever you call it, and there's the stuff that was left behind, like the drawings. Some of the waiting rooms off to the right were actual wards, and they basically bunched up all the stuff that was there, and no one had moved it out of place yet, but there's boxes of like these kids' drawings and what, you know, things that were up on the wall, and it's just really bizarre. And those windows and that reinforced, it's a jail. It really is a jail. And so it was really, you know, I snooped around a little bit and got to see some of the stuff that was there, and
yeah,
scary stuff. I mean, children's psychiatric ward, and sure, there's all the craziness. But yeah, so where do we start? I mean, the research for that was just, you know, when I work, I try to approach my work really, really simple. I really try to draw a very straight line from what is the motivation, right? What is the object, and why is this little piece of history happening right here, right now? Which means that there's something that catapulted this moment, and then a lot of people don't talk about that, but there's a moment, because it affects the now. The moment after always affects how you behave now. Like, we have expectations of what we're going to be doing in an hour or two from now, and that is not as much as what's before, but it's still affecting you. And you know, one of the things about the show with me was, like, you know, I'm a recurring character, and so I don't have a lot of information, and there's nothing like being thrown into the fire. And really, producers didn't give me the same amount of pre-information to sort of gauge me as to why this is happening. They just give me my 4 or 5 pages and go fly on your own. So it's like being thrown right into the fire, and you know, thank God for all those years of studying this work and understanding what this is about, because it was very necessary for me to have that, you know, technical knowledge of what this work was about, sort of, so I can prepare and do 4 or 5 pages without someone saying, oh, well, you know, she, you know, you're involved with the mother, and the mother left, and then you got to see her daughter, and then why'd you get involved with the daughter? Who cares? Who knows? You know, he's just a horny guy, I guess. I don't know. And and then he's a drug dealer, and so there wasn't a lot of detail. So, yeah, you know, it all, I really try to like make these very simple direct lines for the work, and a starting point and an ending point, and just, you know, just start doing the work and homework. It's really all about homework and reading it and doing it and reading it and doing it. And you arrive at these things that kind of feel, I want it to feel organic. I don't want to feel like I'm forcing something to happen in the moment. I want it to feel like it just, like it's an accident almost like it's a really, it should feel very organic, very like there's no effort being made. There is an effort.
Yeah.
You know the story.
Sure.
And we, you know, that's the technical part also, that you know the story, but you got to immerse yourself in a way that you're kind of arriving at these things anew every single time. And that takes days, man. That takes days, and it takes practice.
We were talking a little bit backstage about how the humor of that character is not necessarily written into that scene or that character.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, whether it was directed or brought from you, how do aspects like that come into the character?
I'm so terrified of comedy. In fact, I don't consider myself, you know, it's like, you know, I remember years ago, someone asked me about, what do you want to do? You want to do comedy? You want to do drama? And I was like, I want to do drama. I want to do really deep stuff. Comedy's scary because there's this response that you're waiting for. When you're a comedian or you're up on stage, right, you gotta wait. People have to laugh, because if they don't laugh, then I guess you're not funny.
Sure.
But when you approach this work like this here, I think that one of the things I learned is that I think what's funny is the clarity that he has, right, in his objectives. And I think that the audience will perceive the fact that, yes, what a crazy contradiction you have when somebody's actually such a low life, and yet look at that, like he's sort of taking care of things. So yeah. I drew that line very distinctly in the preparation process, and I wanted to make sure that I was just really arriving at things from this organic way, that felt honest. Like, he's this thug, but he has responsibilities. I mean, and it's not like we don't, we all know somebody like that in real life. You know, we have cousins and friends of cousins and people. And, you know, I've grown up around people. And, you know, I grew up a block away from some projects by me. And I have family members. I borrowed this stuff from a lot of people, from experiences in my life. Yeah. I know what it's like to be living on the edge of the seat. You know, I know what it's like to be in low-income housing. I know what it's like to, you know, sell a little weed on the corner. And, you know, I know what that's like. I've been there. I've seen what that's like. And but that doesn't mean that these people, 10 or 20 minutes later or an hour later, they're not going home and preparing a meal for someone they care about.
Sure.
You know what I mean?
It's, oh, yeah.
All these, it's sort of like the colors of, this is why this work is so important to me, because I think that I give voice to these things.
Right.
And I think that that's a very, very powerful thing. But as far as the approach is concerned, you know, you just tell it like it is and be honest about the work.
Yeah.
The work is going to come through and the funny stuff is going to happen, but you can't really work to make those things funny.
There's definitely that push-pull taking place where on the surface you may judge César as a bad or an evil character, but then in a way he's more committed than the guard. I think his name's John.
John.
Who eventually just takes off and leaves the pregnant prisoner to fend for herself,
yeah.
Right? So in a way that...
I mean, his work was different than mine, I think, in many ways, because I think that he did a great job as far as... because he's really fearful of the situation. I mean, he's just, you know, he's a little bit out of his league. Mm. I think, you know, for me, when I saw the script and I, because he's scared, you know, he's a guard, but he's also a little bit scared, and he has these people like porn stash, who's a real like the hero guy. He's the real like, you know, correctional officer, fearless kind of guy, and this guy is sort of, he's meandering around, really doing a job probably just because that's what he can get, and he just came off, you know, the army or what have you. But it's different. It's a different preparation for him, and I think it's clear, and I think he does a great job. So yeah, that's clear with his work. You know, he's definitely not in it as far, because César's not going nowhere, right? César has no options really.
Right.
Like, this is his life, and he's probably not going to sell drugs up until the point he gets enough money to open up his own, you know, clinic somewhere, right? Like, this is, he's not gonna have a dispensary where he's gonna be able to do this legally. Like, yeah. This is the everyday hustle. And I think a guy like that has, you know, talk about having that work ethic of kind of looking ahead. Like, that guy probably lives with a week or two in front of his life. Like, he's not even thinking about next year or a month from now. His life is, I woke up today, and as far forward as I can see is a week or two.
Yeah.
And that's it.
Yeah.
You know, so yeah. His perspective is much different.
Sure.
So he's committed to everything that's happening now. And notice that it's all really forceful, right? It's really just, there's no real... foresight, you know, there's nothing really looking ahead, there's no future, and it's a shitty way to live, you know, but it's the way some people live.
Yeah, I have a couple more questions and then we'll open it up to the audience, but wondering with regards to, you said that with Orange is the New Black you were given your sides and you could kind of do your own work without having to worry necessarily about being on set every day. You've done other film work where you've worked more closely with a director, right? And I'm sure you've gone through rehearsals and preparing for a more elaborate character throughout who drives the film or throughout the course of the film. So could you talk a little bit about what that process is like, especially, you know, in our classes we're reinforcing that importance of rehearsing, that you don't just step in front of a camera and master the script, right? So.
Yeah, I mean, listen, my initial work in this business was a lot of off-Broadway work. I sort of consider myself a theater guy. That's really where, you know, being in New York, you're an actor in New York, you don't have a cousin or a brother who's gonna like introduce you to somebody and put you in a film or in a TV show. My evolution has really been very slow. And so I started, you know, doing off Broadway, and I've never done a Broadway play, but I've done enough theater work to understand that, you know, this really is a process. And borrowing a little bit from my athletic life, you know, like, I used to love practice. I would, like, as a kid, I would sometimes sleep with my equipment on. And that was a little silly and weird, but there was something that I used to love about just feeling the pads on me. And I was the first guy out in the field, and I mean, they made me captain junior year, and I can go through all the accolades. I was a bit of a beast, and I was pretty, I was moved up to varsity as a sophomore in high school. Like, I was just that gung-ho about the sport, you know, and I did really well. I mean, I did really, really well. So there was this element, but what got me there was this, I just love practice. And I would gear up for practice, and I would every practice was almost like a game to me. Game was another level. Game was just like, you know, I mean, I remember, like, I used to have my coach used to tell me slow down, because I would literally almost faint in the warm-ups. Because I was screaming, and, you know, I was the captain, so I was in charge of, like, you know, lifting everybody's, getting everybody going and whatnot. And I spent so much energy in that pregame that by the time the game started, I needed, like, you know, a cupcake and a whole, you know, pint of orange juice to get me going again, because I really just, that's how much I, you know. And the same thing with theater. Like, you're not always going to find people that want to do this work. You're going to find people that are going to want to do that. Like, you know, I mean, if you have a page or two, like, that's, after a certain point in your career, you can do that. You know, once you know the beginning and the end, once you know the story, you can do that. But, you know, you can get so much from spending an hour rehearsing that scene, and, you know, not really for any other purpose other than to just have fun and just see where it goes. And maybe you do it angry, maybe you do it, you know, monotone, maybe you're try to cry even though you're reading some hilarious lines, you know, like, just try all kinds of things that are kind of like produce a result that you are not expecting you're going to have. And you're going to arrive at a performance that's probably going to get really, really close to what the intention of that scene is. Mm-hmm. And not only that, you're going to know the work inside and out, and you're going to have this ability to play. And that all comes from theater. That was a great thing about doing plays. Like, the play was never the same. A 4-week run, you know, there was always something. And you always hear actors, oh, God, I didn't feel that one. But there was always the opportunity to do it again the next day. And on top of that, you may have not felt it, but you still had to finish the scene. It's not like you can stop and do a retake, or you're in that moment, you're living in that moment. And so maybe you didn't feel something really, really, like, that you didn't work for that feeling, but it was organic and you were still involved in the scene, in the work. And as this is happening, you can't stop, you don't stop life. You don't stop this conversation right now, right? And TV and camera work, you're allowed to do that, but with the theater, you can't.
Yeah.
And there's so much you can gain from that. And if all actors did that, like, imagine, like, the quality of the work that you would see.
Sure.
You know what I mean? So it all stems from that original, you know, it all comes from theater work. It all comes from that flexibility, that, you know, that volley that happens. It's like a volley back and forth that people have, you know. That's what we're doing right now. It's a conversation, you know what I mean? Acting is not really reacting. Acting is just living. And I'm going to feed off of what you say and do, and you're going to feed off of what I say and do. And that's what you got to recreate. Mm-hmm. That's really it.
Well, unfortunately, season 3 ends. César gets arrested.
Yeah.
So we talking backstage, we don't quite know if he's ever going to work his way back into the show. We said that, you know, it's good because your character didn't die. So
yeah, that's the one thing. They didn't kill me, so there's a possibility
right.
There.
He could come back, right? But right now, your latest jobs were on Conviction.
Yeah.
Do you want to talk a little bit
sure,
about...
Sure, sure. So, I mean, I got really lucky this last year. I've started off with a, you know, strong year. I went to Toronto in November, and I spent 20 days there, and I did a guest star on Conviction, which... Here's the reality. You're going to do a lot of stuff, and a lot of stuff is going to go away really quick. But nevertheless, the experience is always going to propel you forward, and it's going to, you know, it's going to help your profile. It's going to help you grow as an artist or as a director. So every work begets more work. And that's the thing. You know, this work lived at the top of my list for the time that it did, and it aired, and it was a good reception, and it was good work. But now, you know, the show may not come back. Three or four of the actors are on to, actually a couple of them were actually in Vancouver doing other pilots and other work. So it's transient. And so you just got to keep going. This thing happened with Conviction, and it was great. And then from that point, November till it aired, so there was a span of December, I got close to doing two plays, didn't happen. Kind of heartbroken there. I had a, you know, you have this high of working, and then you're going back to the sort of low of dealing with, I didn't get that one, I didn't get this one. And so that affects you, you know? And so, but you have to stay prepared because, you know, we all know, I don't know if you guys know this, but the January through really early, mid-December through like end of February, mid-March, all the new seasons and all the new shows start casting, and you know, you have a lot of, you know, a lot of people going in for them here in New York and in LA. And so you have to stay ready, and these little lows have to vanish really quick, and you have to prepare yourself and get ready and get amped and get energized again for these opportunities that are going to be coming up in January and February. And so that's what I did. And it was a trying year because, again, I have certain expectations, and I'm a very ambitious person. And, you know, I've been at this for a long time, and I want to elevate my status to the next level. And I had hopes, and I sort of had this idea. I was like, this is going to happen. And, you know, sometimes it doesn't. And I think that's, you just have to always stay ready. You have to always stay ready. And your work can't suffer, because the reality of this work is that you're going to get 5 to 10% of it. So, I mean, I think I'm just, at the end of the day, I think I'm just a lunatic, because you really got to be completely mad or just have this crazy confidence in what you're doing. But, you know, this year I got lucky enough, and you know, you keep on trying, and, you know, of course, along the way, I'm now represented by amazing management and amazing agent, and that's all taken so long too. Like, and I hope, please, guys, don't ask me to describe it. All I can say is that if you're an actor looking for representation, you just have to, you know, send your photos out every year, talk to as many people as you can talk to, and just get an agent and get a manager. But now that you have that, now that you have these people sort of like, you know, vouching for you and representing you, you let them know. It's like, listen, it's time to stop doing co-star nonsense. It's time to, I want to go in. I may not go in as much as I was going in before, but I want to go in for serious regular roles only, do or die, right? And so that's what you set out to do, and that's what the whole plan was this year. And I think I had eight auditions this year, nine auditions. And it was the ninth one. And the ninth one happened on Thursday. On Saturday, there was this crazy mess going on about whether or not they were going to test me, because that's the other thing, you have to test. And sometimes this process is like 4 or 5 steps. And I know, in fact, that for some of the other leads in this show, like Laverne Cox from Orange is the lead in this show, she got taken off one show that she was in doubt this year, canceled, and 3 days later she was on this show. The other lead, Megan Rath, she tested 13 actors in a span of 3 or 4 weeks, because she had been picked since early December. And the rest of the people, Michael Cudlitz, Tim Kang, John Schwartzky, all these people sort of, like, they're more established, so that it happened for them a little bit quicker. But Thursday, Saturday, and then on Tuesday, I was told, yeah, you got it on Tuesday at noon, and at 7 o'clock, I was on a plane to Vancouver. So 7 hours later. So this stuff, you know, there's no pattern.
Yeah.
You know, this is a crazy business, so think twice about what you all are doing, because really, you got to have the thickest skin and really, really confident, and know yourself.
That's the trustee, right?
So this is the trustee, right? Sorry, that's the trustee. And you'll only see it if it gets picked up. Like, The experience of itself was amazing.
Sure.
And I'm a winner. I got a pilot, so I already won. I got something. I elevated myself to a new level as it is. But if the show gets picked up, then we got to go to work.
Yeah.
And then it's 6 months in Vancouver, and then that's gonna be a nice challenging adventure.
Are the girls ready for Vancouver?
I don't know. I don't think they are.
All right, let's open
it up. Whatever. It's comfy.
To some
comfy
audience questions and Travis.
Let's do it.
So you mentioned that for a while you were doing 2 to 3 other jobs. Were those jobs outside the industry while you were trying to get industry jobs? And if so, which ones were like the most flexible for allowing you to get jobs?
So listen, I've been lucky enough to work in some of the best clubs in New York. And so I've got used to this way of life, and I really needed to have these high paying jobs. And for me, it was nightclubs and bartending at this, you know, upscale, like the Lavos and the Hudson Terrace and the big clubs in New York, because I got used to that. And I got lucky enough that I got in early enough. So yeah, I mean, I was a PA for 2-3 years. And you know, honestly, for my path, it didn't help me at all. It was almost like a joke. Like if I being on set, working as a PA, telling people that my path was more of a less technical and more of a like front of the camera, they were like, what the hell are you doing here? Like you're waking up at 4 o'clock in the morning to go get a queue in the city and fill it up with equipment in 4 or 5 different places in the city and then go back to Brooklyn for this. I mean, that's not what an actor ever. Guys in the technical side, you know, producers or writers or directors, anybody that's following that path, I think it's absolutely necessary for all you guys to start there, because that's gonna get, you're gonna be in front of directors, and that's an industry where you're gonna meet guys that are gonna keep bringing you on for other jobs in that capacity, and so it's absolutely necessary. But for me, I brought a reel in once and I gave it to somebody and I think like literally I turned my back and they chucked it in the garbage. I mean, it was like, it is what it is. It didn't break my heart. It, you know, whatever. His loss, right?
La La Land style.
But it's just, that's a process of discovering things, right? I'm not discouraging you, but I'm letting you know that my experience wanting to be in front of the camera, it didn't work for me and it wasn't, maybe it worked for some other guys that did PAing, but for me, it wasn't. But I think it's super valuable, you know, like I got to work for Wesley Snipes Amun-Ra company at the very, very early stages of it. And I worked at RZA and I did a video with these guys. And that one time that I was on this job, I did get lucky and they used me as a bartender in a scene working with RZA, but that was once in 3 years.
Yeah.
And I didn't get paid for it or anything. It was like they were short a guy that day and they just put me on. So, you know, This is really all about just kind of process of discovery and some things that you turn some cards and they work, and then sometimes you turn other cards and they don't. But staying, I think the point of your question, staying involved in something that's in the industry could be beneficial for you. I mean, I don't know what track you're on, but it could be helpful, I think.
I feel like the first time I think Mark told me that you appeared in Fighting for a brief second, the Channing Tatum film.
Yeah, I did that.
And I was
one,
like,
yeah,
looking for him. I'm like, I don't know, I can't find him. Where is he? Is it like?
So the scene was a lot longer when we shot it. And then of course, you know, he's so beautiful to look, I guess much better to look at than me, but you know, it's you have some pretty good looking people and I don't think they're gonna be interested in the guy off to the side kind of challenging Channing on the side. And so the scene got cut a lot. And yeah. I was crazy enough. I took my daughters to the theater with me that day, and they were really little, and I only did that just to see what, I knew that it was gonna be pretty short.
Yeah.
And literally, they were going nuts.
Yeah.
They were going crazy in the theater wanting to go. You know, obviously it was a little too much for them, and I waited all that time. I was sweating, and then I watched it, and I'm not even on, I didn't even come out. I mean, it was just like you hear me say something. It's the scene where I come out of the bathroom and like they're meeting for the first time and there's that moment. And I guess I was kind of hitting on her, like my character was hitting on her before.
Yeah.
And there's that moment after the bathroom and no, but you know, they just focus on Channing. Just stayed on Channing. I don't blame him.
You didn't deserve a cutaway.
I had a real good moment with him. I mean, to me that was great, and I was like, yeah, I'm gonna fuck you up right now, brother. What's up? I had all this preparation, and it was, you know, I challenged him on scene, and he was, you know, he had a moment with me, but then no, it's over.
Back here, yeah.
You're very lucky in that you get to be on one of like the top three breakout shows
ever.
Of Netflix. Like,
yeah.
Like you're on one of the shows that put Netflix on the
absolutely
map, you know, that really challenged like a regular
broadcast. It changed the industry. I mean, let's just face it, yeah.
Absolutely. And then you also have work with this, with the convictions, like that's on
network, like more network.
Exactly. Do you find that there's any sort of difference in terms of how they approach filming it or writing it? Like, would you say that, let's say, oh, when we make the Netflix show, there are these sorts of things you got to keep in mind, whether it be demographics or scheduling or things like that? Are there any differences in how?
I mean, there's so many. I mean, time and the speed of production and network television is fast. You don't have that time constraint with Netflix just because their design is almost like a film, right? You're shooting 13 episodes. There's no real pressure of airing those episodes in real time. So you have 2-3 weeks to do one. And just to put it in perspective, to do a pilot for a network television, a pilot, it's 3.5 weeks to almost 4 weeks in, you know, in the setting. And that's a really long process for television. They grant you that because when you produce a pilot in television for network, you have all this money and it's a tryout, right? They want to make sure production is right, everything is right, and they give you 3 weeks. That's network for a pilot. When you're shooting a regular episode, you're done in 7 days or maybe 9 days. So in between those 9 days, you may have 2 weekends or not, but more often than not, you start on Monday and midweek the next week, you're done with an entire episode. So there's that. There's that aspect of the speed and the way, and everyone feels it, right? Actors, everyone feels that need to finish quickly and to get things done. Netflix, it's 3 weeks, and it's really done more like a movie. There's more of a process, there's more time, there's a lot of downtime too, which I try to use that in a positive way to prepare. And then there's also in network television, you have a production house, Netflix, and a lot of these shows on Netflix, you're going to have writer producers, right? So the people that create the work are also producing that work. And that can be very beneficial or it can be sometimes detrimental, depends. Now in networks, you have a director who's interpreting the work of a writer who more often than not is not there. You know, because in the networks, to be honest, they don't really want writers around because of this necessity for speed. Otherwise, you'd have these guys in the back, you know, no, you got to do this differently, right? You know, so that coming from like my point of view, like as an actor, it presents different challenges, right? As far as like how in tune you have to work with what you have to do and, you know, the environment that creates. Right? I mean, everyone kind of feels it a little bit differently. And I think you just have to be ready to roll with whatever, you know, with whatever you get thrown at you. I mean, your job, you know, I don't know what track you're on. You maybe as a director, you'll feel other, maybe as a writer, you'll feel something different. Maybe as a technical person, you'll feel something different. But, you know, I think the speed for the most part. And I think also as far as the preparation, just a quick note to Netflix shows, all my work, I think that I try to arrive at this performance ahead of time, just so that I'm flowing better when it's time to really do it for real. You know, you're encapsulating a lot of work and a lot of things that need to be very precisely your behavior has to be very precise in order to get the work across, right? So you got to have a mini explosion, so to speak, as an actor. And network, you know, you got to have that ready and ready to go on the spot, because they're not going to let you redo it if you don't feel it's good. And unfortunately, that's just the way it goes. You're going to come close to something that you wanted to do, right? And whether it's the best you were going to do at that moment or not, right? Your personal best is one thing. They're not going to wait for you. You may get maybe an extra day with Netflix, but networks don't really wait. And so I think that that's the biggest thing, that the difference is. And then, of course, when you work with people like in Netflix and like even film, I think, when you're working with a writer directly who's also a producer and in some cases even perhaps directing, I find it to be really beneficial, because there's a certain clarity that comes with that.
Sure.
Although a good director can give you that clarity or help you along the way, right? Like guide you in network as well. But when it's right there in front of you, like there's certain liberties that you have. And so I think all of that, you know, once you start working, you'll see and feel the differences from one medium to the next. Film is the same way. Sometimes you have a film that's low budget and you got to also work kind of fast. And then, you know, fighting was, I had days to do, days to do 2 minutes. So. Yeah, I would. I mean, and just, it depends on the kind of work that you're doing. I mean, if you have something that's, you know, register your work, right, with SAG and AFTRA, and you can ask them. They have resources as well. SAG-AFTRA has resources and a good way to make contact with people. And then you can start reaching. It really is all about relationships, so you got to start somewhere. I mean, the very easy way is to put out an ad, look for actors, and then you'll get Joe Schmo, and you may or not get somebody that can actually interpret the work that you're putting out there. But that's the difference between putting out an ad or going through the process of, you know, going to a seminar or going to the SAG-AFTRA office or, you know, going to these network meets that they have in the city sometimes, where you get to meet casting people and managers. And so, you know, it's a much lengthier process that way. But the quality of people that you're going to get responding to your work is going to be much better. But I, you know, honestly, do it all, because you never know. I wouldn't underestimate the power of just putting out a simple ad. There's this new what's this thing that they have on Facebook? Actors, iActor or
something. Maybe a group page or something like that. Or?
There's so many casting. You know, now with the social media, you can literally put a post on Facebook. You know, you can literally post on Facebook or Instagram, or like, I don't know about Twitter, but I think Facebook and Instagram there's so many resources out there.
Yeah.
But I think making the contact with the people that are gonna sort of funnel the talent and send you guys that can give you the interpretation that you're looking for is also gonna be beneficial.
Should we plug your social media now at El Berto Colón, right?
Sure. Am I supposed to do that?
Is that all the handles? Or?
Yeah, El Berto. You don't even need to. I don't know why people. Sometimes I don't know why people do. You just put your name in Google and you'll get all the Instagram.
Right.
You get everything.
Right,
so
right.
There's no need for plugs anymore.
Any other questions, Santa? I know you had one. Are you still thinking about it or?
Oh God, look, this is my experience with this, right? If in my preparation process I start thinking about that, I'm not really gonna achieve what I need to achieve, right? At the end of the day, somebody wants to typecast me, they're in control of that, I'm not. You're also talking to a Latino guy who can sometimes not be as Latino, so I kind of have to thread lightly on the subject, because so many people are going to say, yeah, well, you don't have it as hard as I do. But there's what I'm trying to get at is this. That's not a problem that in my experience, I'm not going to tell you how you want to approach it, but in my experience, it's not really something that I can prepare for. I cannot control that. And I've been at this for so long now that I can't really sit there and worry about that. I did a podcast last night, and that was one of the subjects. And, you know, you look like what you look like. And you're going to fit roles that are in, write your own stuff if you don't want to get typecast. That's the immediate answer that I'm going to give you. But it's going to take a long time for you to be able to write your own work and produce your own work, right? So I guess you got to play the game. I think Caesar, for all intents and purposes, is a total type. But I really did not approach that guy like most people would have. I approached that guy like Berto Colón could only approach that guy, not like anyone else can. But a lot of people can pretty much say that that's, a lot of people think that I was gonna only do that kind of work after I did that. It may or may not be. People have very nice careers doing that kind of work for a very long time. So it just depends on what you wanna do. And really, the typecasting thing is not something that you can consider, especially when you're not in control of casting it. Yeah. Casting the work, I mean.
Right here?
What is your dream role like, you want to actually do?
I want to save the world, man. I want to be Tom Cruise in War of the World. I just want to... I want to do a biopic about Luis Muñoz Marin, you know? I don't know, I have a lot of ideas. I want to do a Warren film. I want to do like a Puerto Rican version of the 65th Infantry, sort of like a cross between Hamburger Hill and Full Metal Jacket, you know? Like, those are dream roles. It just, my dream role is to take a subject that, a powerful subject, right? Something that affects, you know, affects us as a society, affects us as people, and have people be able to look at that role and you know, kind of like, you know, Last of the Mohicans, you know, like a role like, you know, like Shawshank Redemption, or take a role like that that encompasses just this crazy condition of just being a human being, surpassing so many things, and at the end of it, maybe not winning, you know, the guy in The Professional. Right?
Sure.
He got killed at the end, but that's, you know, Mark and I always talk about that film because he, in a way, he sort of won. Yeah. But the price of that victory was not going to be him walking off into the sunset like, you know, Pale Rider or anything. I mean, sometimes that's the kind of role you want. You want a role that encompasses the full spectrum of, like, the human condition, right? And that you have an impossible obstacle that no one thinks you can get through, and you somehow get through it.
Yeah.
But not because it was expected, but just because going along the way you did, you know, like something like that. Maybe a doctor. Maybe a doctor that saves a little girl from dying from cancer.
That'll work, right?
That'll work. That'll work too.
We have time for one more. Rich?
Got a question for you. I had a lot of actors, actresses. When I was in New York, I met so many people. And the one thing I noticed about actors, actresses, entertainers, they never seem to register their .com name.
Oh.
I wonder why.
You know, I have a .com.
They're not serious about it, that they don't
mind. Yeah. Well, look, you know, that's one of those things. Like, do we really need a website now? I mean, I have a website that I have not gotten it up and running because there's Facebook and there's social media now.
They
and
got Wix, so they got some free site, they got Model Mayhem, but they won't. All you do is type in the GoDaddy, and 90% of them, it's available.
I have it, and you know what? You're kind of motivating me now. I'm going to get that up and going. I have, you know what it is for me? As an actor, what are you saying? Oh, so you're trying to sell me something now.
I mean, they don't care about being serious. Maybe one day they might.
I mean, that's also your that's an interpretation, and that's your own, and I respect that, and I understand how some people would kind of make that a requirement for their, right, like your requirement. But as an actor, IMDb is really enough. But you know what? You're right. You should take every step possible and then get a, you know, and that would be kind of like icing on the cake, right? Like, I think that that's, you know what, you're right. If that's kind of like what completes it for you, and that's what you consider somebody that's complete and doing all their work, then kudos, you know? I mean, I applaud you for that.
It just seems like a cheap way of advertising.
It's easy enough. It's easy enough. But we're also living in a society now that doesn't know really process anymore. You know, they're going to get a Facebook page and Instagram, and that's really it. And they're just going to, I mean, it's very hard. And independent. I mean, I'm 43, so I'm agreeing with you, but I don't think you're going to sell that to a 20-something-year-old or maybe a 30-something-year-old. You know, I don't know. I'm just speculating. Again, I respect your, I mean, I think it's a good way to cover all your bases, and I'm all about that. But there's a lot of ways to be effective, to get your profile out there. And I think really what it is, I think a lot of people consider that to be a little outdated. You know, like whoever is going to go on a website, and when you have Google, just Google me, man. I mean, you'll find me. If you want to really find me, you Google me.
Twitter is the new webpage to riff off of Orange is the New Black, right?
So. And I think Twitter is really Twitter is sort of like, kind of like you raise your hand in a classroom. It's just like a sign. Yeah. Sort of, because you can't really put a lot of content down there.
Sure.
And I don't think that it should, you know, let that be, the more detailed stuff should be on Facebook, and there should be another. I think Twitter is more of a, like, quick sign, like signage, you know, like a quick announcement here, a quick announcement there, make it known, make it official, but do it through all. Like, you know, you can basically do one, and now they all, right?
Yeah.
If you put one, if you make one post on Instagram, you could send it to Facebook and Twitter all at once, so. So, a lot of ways to skin a cat.
So Santa has a follow-up that
has
she
a follow-up.
Seems
okay.
Very eager to ask.
Yes.
And then we're going to go to Sophia and Tali in the back because they have had their hands up this whole time.
I'm sorry,
literally,
sweetheart.
They have not put their hands down.
Honorary college students today.
So let's go with Santa and then we'll...
Funny you would ask. So in 2007, I did the show called Viva Hollywood, which is kind of like what really put me on this. I guess I should have spoken about this, right? I guess I didn't.
Yeah.
It was intended to be a competition for like Latino name actors who refused, like the Sofia Vergara when Sofia Vergara was not Sofia Vergara. And then they were like, no, there's no way we're going to do that. So they selected up and coming no names. I was one of them. And we went to LA and we shot this competition. It's still up somewhere. And it was called Viva Hollywood. And the whole purpose of that was to give the winner an opportunity to go to Miami and film a telenovela. And I won, luckily enough. And in typical industry fashion, and mind you, I am, my second language is English. Like, I grew up speaking Spanish. Well, I went to Miami, and I guess my Spanish wasn't good enough to do novelas. Because, listen, I told you I was going to break some hearts today. The neutralization of the Spanish accent is very peculiar, but that's a bunch of shit because they don't
cubano,
like any
right?
Caribbean Spanish accents. They do not like the real accents that they're looking for is a Mexican. But check this out: it's not a Mexican that you would think that we typically hear, right? They want a DC, Distrito DF. A Distrito Federal accent, which is almost just short of like Spain Spanish, except none of the zetas. So they don't do that, but their Spanish is very neutral. And Colombia and Venezuela for a second and third. So they're, you know, it's some of the, and it's true, like the Spanish language is very, in Puerto Rico, we mess it up. Dominican Republic and Cuba, forget it. I mean, it's just like, what the? I don't even know how to. So the accents that you, when you want to listen to like a really nice Spanish accent, you watch telenovelas, I guarantee you they're either Mexican DF, educated in DF, Colombian, well-educated Colombians, or well-educated Venezuelans. I'm not putting anyone else out. I'm sure that there are others there. But that's how they do it there. And by the same token, in this market, like, I probably can spend the rest of my life doing César, but if I don't neutralize my English and sound like that all the time, like, it is kind of like, I'm kind of comfortable in this, right, where I am right now, but if I need to turn that off and become completely neutral, I can, But that's how important this stuff is with language too. Like you have to, you really gotta, you know, language is a big deal in this industry for actors especially. And you gotta be able to meet their expectations, bottom line. So yeah, I'll go back and do novellas if they hire me, you know. I was up for the new, this new Narcos that they have going right now in Telemundo. And they love the tape.
We were always wondering about Pablo Escobar because yeah, he's a Brazilian.
No, well, yeah.
It sounded.
But he crushed it. He crushed it. And listen, there's a lot of politics with that. The director of that series is a prolific Brazilian director who directed him in a series that was huge in Brazil called Suicide Squad. So he fought for his guy to be the lead on the, and this happens, and this is a reality. And you know what? The guy did an amazing job.
Yeah.
I mean, I don't think a lot of Colombians agree with me. He did have moments where it kind of, I guess, right? I mean, any Colombians in here? No? Okay, good. He did have some moments that were not total, like, perfect dialect Colombian. But he fooled everyone else.
Yeah.
And not only that, is like the emotional life of this guy and the portrayal of this guy was really on point, you know, I thought.
Sure. Sophia and Talia, ask your question.
Laila,
sorry.
Okay. Hi, go ahead, guys, don't be shy.
Why did you start acting?
Because I started acting because I loved it. It's just, you know, when you start studying and when you go to school and you get a little bit older than when you are now, you're gonna wanna do a lot of things throughout your life, and that's okay. I hope that you wanna become president one day. But then something happens that there's sort of a moment that you have, you discover something that you really like a lot, and then you wanna do that for real. For real. And then you keep trying.
And Laila, did you want to ask your question? What do you got?
How many?
I've done a few. Like 10 or 12. 10 or 12.
Well, I just want to say, JP, I know you had a follow-up. Berto's going to be here, so I invite you guys to come introduce yourselves. Come say hello, follow on social media, share your social media.
Yes,
probably
please.
Get a follow back, right?
Yes, of course.
And yeah, just come say hello, introduce yourselves. You know, Berto would love to hear what you do. And also, thanks for coming. I know that we appreciate the audience.
Thank you.